Now, you know, when I was director of council of all five, I was a response officer because I also ran a pension fund there. But that pension fund is 750 million. Pension fund here is 7 billion. It's about 8 times as big. And you've got 130,000 members here that less than 20,000 walk in forest. So I could do both jobs as head of the fund and director of finance. Here, it's different, and it is appropriate that, you know, the ultimate responsibility and ultimate reporting to the committee is by the decision maker, the officer decision maker, and that is the head of funds. So I think that's a very good change. I'd also like to commend again, on page 120, that notwithstanding the creation of this board, which gives hopefully a greater emphasis to the views of both employees and employers, that the committee still has employee representation. The trade union representatives are still there, because I think it would be to the detriment of the LGPS and its individual members if, and it may have happened elsewhere, the trade union representatives and other employee representatives were removed from the committee.
Pensioners representatives too.
When I say employees, I mean pensioners. Yeah? When we move from the committee and simply placed on the board, I think it's appropriate if we're going to strengthen the influence of both employers and employees that they should be represented on both the committee and the board, and that is the continuing policy of Will, and I think that again should be commended. I'd also like to comment on the decision-making structure on page 123. I mean, perhaps we can talk about that a bit more in the exempt when we look at the two working party members, particularly, I suppose, Kerry and myself have been to the working party recently, but I would say again that that structure is pretty comprehensive and allows a lot of thought and governance and consideration to go on within this fund before things come to the Pensions Committee. You know, there are places where things go to the Pensions Committee and perhaps there's not as much consideration as there is at Liverpool, where you have particularly the two working parties, which are both officer and member working parties. And then, of course, you have the fund operation group, which, you know, is formally constituted and recorded, so the head of the fund has to hold it. And I think, again, that is positive, that fund operation group is formally recognised as part of the government structure. So, again, I would positively commend that. Final comment I make on pages 128 to 130, where the government's compliance statement, that is a statement which is required by the Secretary of State to be made by each fund against a set of tests that he laid down 10 years ago, you know, Peter. And again, it is very pleasing to note the responses in there, and I think if you track back, and I did sort of try and track back, that the answers in there are genuine, yes, honest answers. And I think the fact that this fund can answer these questions briefly, honestly and genuinely, again, says an awful lot for the overall government instruction and the positivity of that. That's all. What my thoughts. Apart from that, can we note the report? Thank you. Item 9, member development programme, Peter? Page 137.
Yes, I brought a copy to the board of the programme that's been put in place for members of the Pensions Committee. As we say, under 2.1, there's a regulatory requirement for LGPS funds to outline in their statement of investing principles the extent of their compliance with the miners principles. And in those principles, miners emphasise them and continues to emphasise the importance of adequate training for those acting on a pensions committee. As I say, under 2.3, a number of these opportunities will also be made available to pension board members. So the appendix to the report outlines, should, if attached, would outline the, I apologise for that, that the development programme.
It's on page 144.
Sorry, yes, I'm looking at the report. Yes. So there are a number of elements there for Pensions Committee. We feel it's fairly comprehensive. Some of those are open to pension board members, in particular the June LGPC conference, and we'll certainly be advising you of other opportunities later on in the year. I know the event in February, the chair was able to attend that. And we will be looking for further opportunities for perhaps another internal training event, such as we held at the QNAB last year, for pension board members.
Can I just say that I've been invited to be a speaker on the 17th of May, what used to be called the NAP, at the Network of Lifetime Pensions.
PLSA, yeah. Pensions and Lifetime Savings.
There is a session on the 17th of May talking about what makes a good pension board. And I've been watching a panelist on
that. The Queen is taking us all
Just to interject, I noticed at the NAPS, or whatever it's called now, investment conference, there was the ability that they had some of their presentations webcast. So I wonder if they're doing that in May, whether we could use that for nil cost.
Certainly, if it's available, I'll circulate details and I'll certainly do that in the future. Yes.
Can I just mention that I'm unable to attend the annual conference as it clashes with the European referendum, I'm the presiding officer. And I've already said, yes, I will do the job.
So likewise, I have it proposed.
Sorry. They asked first.
I also understand it doesn't clash with the European Football Championships.
This is genuine.
I don't get the European referendum, we haven't been talking about football.
That's one issue. I didn't say you could put the vote down, but anyway. Does anyone have any thoughts or comments on the report?
Well, we're delighted that you're telling them how good football is.
One of the things I will be saying, actually, I mean, I've been drawing experience here and also Nottinghamshire, sure, but a slightly different role. I've done some training with four other boards, but one of the big issues, and I think it comes from all of the boards that I've worked with, and the first thing, actually, is the attitude of the administering authority. Because I think the thing that people are often forgetting in the whole issue of boards is the attitude of the administering authority, because that's crucial. Because there are some administering authorities are not taking this quite as seriously as the world is. And that's one of the things I'll be pointing out. Because it doesn't matter how enthusiastic the members are, you won't even get members quickly if you don't have an enthusiastic administering authority. And there are some administering authorities where there's been less enthusiasm than others, and I'll be saying that very loud and clear, and using Merseyside as an example where there has been a lot of enthusiasm. The fact that you've got strategic director of resources sitting there at every single meeting, the fact that, you know, the access that I've had to the head of the fund since I've been appointed, the fact that we've got 1, 2, 3, 4 senior officers of the fund at every single meeting, I think says an awful lot about the approach of the administering authority.
Great.
So we'll be making that point loud and clear. It's the attitude of the members and the types of members you get as well, and I'll be making some comments about that as well and what they might do to get members. Again, I think some positive things are done here to get the group of people that we have around the table. Anyway, I'll stop there.
It's very easy to be boastful on this, but we've had a very good attendance as far as board members are concerned. I'll come on to another aspect of that later on.
And a lot of discussion. I mean, I don't think there's a single person who's on the board who hasn't, you know, contributed almost every meeting. I mean, you know, without people sort of banging any particular drum either. You know, we don't have anybody here who's come for an agenda. I mean, people come to openly discuss the reports that the officers have prepared. Okay, can we?
Can I just make just a reminder? Board members have been very good. It was minuted, page 4. Members undertake to report all personal learning and development activities to the fund. I know Emma sends out reminders. You've been very good at providing evidence of your completion of the TPR toolkit, but we will be reporting on training as part of the pension board report, as we do for the pension committee. So if you have attended other events and conferences, we'd be interested to hear, because you know, clearly it will make for a fuller report on training and development, and it's very helpful for us.
There's another spreadsheet reminder be sent out by Amos and Jim Cross.
There's only one problem with that, and I have to admit that I was partially at fault. the toolkit thing that was sent out implied that I hadn't done anything. In fact, I had.
Yes.
There were two of us involved. What I hadn't realised is that I was supposed to tell Emma. And it's been put like now, but I am not a lazy so-and-so. And apart from one particular thing which I've already mentioned, I pass with fine colours, which I can't. So do you think?
Are we content to move to report? Agenda item 10, the investment monitoring working part of these. Can we move to note of the report? Agenda item 11, page 149, the governance of this working party minutes. Can we move to note the report? Item 12, you'll notice there is nothing against the draft pension board report. And the reason for that is it was never intended to punish this particular board, but it's useful just to raise it, just to quickly discuss it. What we intend to do, Peter and myself, is to, in the first year, have the annual report come in a period of 1st of June, when the board was effectively constituted, when we were all appointed, to the 31st of May. Now, to take the first full year, and it also, of course, includes this meeting, so we'll then have perhaps three meetings. So Peter and I will jointly prepare an annual report and a review, which we will circulate to members of the board after we prepare the draft. And then that review will come to the next board meeting. And then after that, that will formally, as it's required to do, go to the Pensions Committee in September. And I think that I will probably be required to appear before the Pensions Committee to present the report and answer the questions of the Pensions Committee. So that's how we'll do. So getting back to the training concerns, I know that people have done a lot of training and done other training. So any training you've done, please return it to Emma, because Peter has to complete an appendix in there detailing what everyone has done. And I think it's important to do that anyway, because there has been a lot of effort by members, and that should be recorded, because again, I think the administrative authority needs to know that, you know, this board here is to assist me generally seeking to fulfil its requirements under the regulations. So that will come to the next board meeting. But as I say, we will be putting a draft plan, because this is supposed to be an annual review and a review of our effectiveness, and I don't think that is for Peter and myself to determine on our own. I think you all should, you know, have the opportunity to comment on the thoughts that Peter and myself have put together before we bring it here. If we move to item 30, which is exclusion of members of the public, the items after these are exempt, so therefore I will read the declaration. And I'm a non-voting member, I would ask for a formal proposal and seconder when I have finished. I'll read a recommendation. Under section 100A4 of the Local Government Act 1972, the public excluded from the meeting during consideration of the following items, that's 14, 15, 16, 17 and 18 of business, on the grounds that they involve the lodging disclosure of exempt information as defined by development paragraph part 1 of Schedule A, 12A, as amended to the Act. The public interest test has been applied in favours exclusion. Do I have a proposal?
I propose, Chair.
Do I have a second? Thank you. And I now ask that the members of the press and public
Sorry. Leave the meeting. You've got to have a vote on it as well.
Have you?
Oh.
Can I pass the
room? Yeah, okay.